I tell all my injured athletes sometimes that like it takes more mental toughness to stop and to take that break and to focus on your recovery than it does to push through. That really, that's the thing that in those moments can really be a true sign of that mental toughness.
This is Running for Real, the podcast for runners who know that for every runner's high, there are just as many lows. All those just missed PRs, easy runs that feel hard, injury blues, and more. Each week, we'll talk to running, health, and wellness experts about their highs, lows, and best advice to build our confidence. Running for Real is about being honest, being brave, and most of all, not feeling alone. And now here's our host, Tina Muir.
Hello, my friends. Welcome to episode 174 of the Running for Real podcast. Thank you so much for joining me. This is coming to you in mid to late February. Already, we are just a week away from the US Olympic trials, and I know many of you are very excited. I am excited, but maybe not as much as you would have learned last week in our episode with Alex, because I am not American, so it doesn't really affect me as much as everyone else, but it is exciting to think about. We are going to find out who the three US marathon Olympian women and the three US Olympian men are going to be going to the Olympics, later this year. So I'm really excited for that. And last week, Alex Hutchinson and I kind of discussed what we think is going to happen, how the shoes have come into it. And as you would have heard, we did record this before the latest rule changes came out, but it was a very, very interesting conversation. Alex kind of guessed what was coming, and we went deeper and I challenged him a lot. So if you missed the episode with Alex, be sure to go back. Now, today we have Cindy Kuzma and Carrie Jackson Cheadle on the show. Now, both of these women have accomplished a lot within their own careers, but we wanted to focus today mainly on injuries, or their new book, which is called Rebound, is about kind of returning from injuries, because no matter how invincible we may feel we are, at some point, injuries are going to come get us. And so I wanted to bring these two on the show. They have written this wonderful book that is made just for people who are going through injuries. But I just want to say, if you aren't someone who is injured right now, don't just switch off, because chances are you have someone in your life who is either struggling with an injury, maybe trying to hide that injury. And as you will hear today, or as you probably know, if you really allow yourself to think about it, it hurts, not just physically, but emotionally, to be injured. So we talk about like what we can do, how we can be supportive, how we can be better friends, how we can be better friends if you're the one injured and everyone around you is just running and you feel very left out and lonely. So this is going to be a great episode for us all to learn. There's some empathy, to just be compassionate and just be supportive. So I'm excited to introduce these two lovely women to you. We are just going to take a moment to thank our sponsors. Then we'll be right to the episode.
Thank you to Vital Farms for sponsoring this episode of the Running for Real podcast. Now, Vital Farms, you may know them for their pasture-raised eggs, which are the ones in the black box. It kind of looks a bit like chalk is written all over them. But in addition to eggs, Vital Farm has been making their pasture-raised butter for years. And they really believe that great ghee starts with better butter, and all that starts with the cows. So pasture-raising the cows that are raised to graze on actual pastures, you know, how cows should be, like in a field, not in some kind of barn pinned together, is just wonderful. I love that they are doing that. And for those of you who don't know, ghee is something that you cook with. It is, kind of a bit like butter, but more rich than butter, I guess. And it is just absolutely delicious when you cook with it. It just steps it up like five levels. I love to roast vegetables in it. They just taste amazing. And if you are someone who loves the food prep, you're going to love that. But anyway, Vital Farms, their ghee is clean. It's a versatile butter oil for every culinary need. It's made by cooking down butter to remove the water and the milk solids, which is also known as clarifying. You learned something today, which means it's lactose and casein free. So that also helps those of you with allergies. Their ghee has a high smoke point, so it doesn't burn or chemically alter at high heat. So it's great for frying, great for sauteing. You can put it on toast. I haven't actually tried that. You could put it in coffee if you are one of those, bulletproof coffee? Yeah, bulletproof coffee people. Drizzled on popcorn, so good. Now, pasture raising ensures that the cows are free to roam and forage on open pastures in these American family farms that they call home. This makes for happy cows, better butter, and now they have greater ghee. So you can actually win a year worth of ghee for free by going to vitalfarms.com/ghee. That's vitalfarms.com/ghee for a chance to win a 1 year supply of Vital Farms ghee for free. So go do it. That's vitalfarms.com/ghee to win a year's supply for free. Carrie, Cindy, thank you so much for joining me on the Running For Real podcast. I am really excited to talk to you both. And, I think my listeners, certainly a specific group of my listeners, are really going to find something that resonates with them today. But to everyone else listening, this is still going to apply to you at some point, unfortunately. So welcome to the show, both of you.
Thanks. Thanks for having us.
Yeah, we're really excited to be here.
I want to start with a little bit about both of you. But before I go on to do that, I just said that, yes, it's going to apply to a certain group of people, which, shocker, is going to be the people who are struggling with injuries or the people who are really in a bit of a down slump. But I did say it's going to apply to everyone. You know, what have, from you two doing the research, what have you found about what percentage or how often do injuries happen? I'm not sure. Maybe Cindy, that's probably you who's done the research on that one. But just how prevalent are injuries?
Yeah, this is Cindy. And I would say in runners specifically, because, you know, we talk to and about and for athletes of all types in our work, runners, I think that the statistics show somewhere around 3/4 of runners will be injured within a year or two. And then I think it's an even higher number in over the course of a running career or a running lifetime. So I do think that most runners, it's kind of a part of, you know, pushing your body in this specific way is you sometimes push a little bit too hard, or sometimes it's not even your fault. You're just, it's a hard sport and it's kind of part of the athletic journey, which is actually something that we talk about a lot.
Yeah. I think that's really important to mention. And that is why I say for anyone who thinks, well, this doesn't apply for me, I'm just going to skip to next week. Listen to it, because when it happens, you know, you'll have these, what we've talked about today, these things in your mind. And then you can go back and listen to it if you need to. You'll also learn some compassion and empathy, how to handle friends who are going through it. Because if you're not injured, chances are you have a friend who is. So, all right, let's learn a bit more about you. Cindy, I'm going to start with you. A freelance writer, you work for many publications, but Runner's World is probably the one that most people listening would have seen you writing for. You also did 6 years working for medical journals, which means that you can provide us with articles that also have the scientific aspect to them and mean that, you know, they're more reliable. So tell us about, you know, how did you get started into kind of writing about running, and what is it about kind of learning, digging into the running side of things that you really enjoy?
Sure, absolutely. So I have a bachelor's and a master's degree in journalism, and I actually didn't grow up a runner or an athlete at all. The most athletic thing I did in school was marching band. But around the time that I was getting my master's in journalism, I was not really taking care of my body and realizing that I wanted to start a fitness program, and running was just the easiest and most convenient thing for me. So I started running then in graduate school about 20 years ago now, and just at the time that I was kind of launching my career as a journalist. So I felt really fortunate to be able to explore topics that I was interested in for work, that just, it all kind of came together and has continued to evolve as my career has evolved, as you mentioned. So I've been a full-time freelance writer for about almost 9 years now, 9 years next month. And I started writing for Runner's World in about 2013, and it was really a dream come true for me to be able to explore these topics. And as you mentioned so often on this show, Tina, you know, I find too that talking about running and writing about running is really writing about life in so many ways. It's a prism through which we kind of view so many other issues. So I feel really grateful that I've been able to explore this as a career.
Yeah, that is really cool. And I've loved so many of your articles. I mean, I think that's how we connected in the first place. And, you know, it's really cool to see where it's taken you and how far you've come since that, you know, time a few years ago, whatever that article that was we were talking about. And Carrie, for you, a certified mental performance consultant. For someone listening thinking, what does that mean? Tell us.
Yeah, so I work in the field of sports psychology. So I get the chance to work with athletes, just like, you know, athletes might have their physical coach or their tactical coaches or their conditioning coaches. I get to be the mental coach and kind of help athletes work on all of the different factors involved with performance that have to do with our feelings of confidence and self-belief. So I get to work on things like motivation and goal setting and confidence and things that we don't always think about as skills, but they really are skills that we can learn and refine and strengthen and be able to build self-awareness around figuring out what obstacles we might have in front of us and then help with the tools of how to manage some of those. So yeah, I mean, just like you said in the beginning, a lot of the stuff that is in the book and a lot of the stuff that we talk about in terms of relating it to the context of being injured, really they, you can take them and apply them to any, you know, performance when you're healthy as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And what about when it comes to, you know, what's the difference between a certified mental performance consultant and a sports psychologist, which is probably the term that most people listening would have maybe heard kind of thrown around for that side of things.
Yeah. So the CMPC is a certification for people that work with athletes. So a sports psychologist might also be CMPC certified, but you do have, there's mental skills coaches or like a high performance coach, and then there's sports psychologists. And a sports psychologist they might also work with athletes on clinical issues in addition to performance enhancement, where I specialize just in performance enhancement. I thought about doing both and decided that was the place where I felt like kind of was my calling. So I have people that I work closely with and refer athletes to if we sort of assess together, me and the athlete that I'm working with, that they might really benefit from other types of support that a sports psychologist might be able to work with. You know, if we are working on anxiety that's more than just performance anxiety or depression or eating disorders or drug addiction, like other clinical issues that impact all areas of life, then I'll work with the athlete as well as a sports psychologist. So some athletes like to work on them separately, and then some like to, if once we identify there's a clinical issue, I'll refer them to a sports psychologist.
Very interesting. Thank you for sharing that.
Yeah.
And as you work with all kinds of sports at every level, what have you noticed about runners as a group compared to other sports? Other than we maybe are crazy.
Well, that is honestly the first thing that came to mind. But I mean, there's such, you know, there's so much crossover, right, between all of the athletes that I have in all of the different sports, but there is such a, in a different way, that's such a great question. I've never really thought about it before, but in a different way, there's this run life connection that seems to be a little bit deeper than other sports, where I really do see my runners that are injured sometimes struggle a little bit more than some of my other athletes because there's such a high athletic identity there. I mean, it really does happen in all sports, but there's something about the running population in particular where it's just, you know, more than any other sport, where if you say you're injured and you go in and you're talking to your medical team and they're like, you know, well, why don't you just swim instead? Or why don't you just do something else instead? And as a runner, you're like, I don't know. I don't want to do that. Is not what I want to do. You know, where other people might be like, oh, you're right. Like, you know, maybe I could do this or maybe I could do that. And it's like, don't tell me I can't do the one thing that brings me more joy than anything else in my life. Like, I can't. I'm going to find another doctor now. Thank you. Goodbye.
So. Yeah. That sounds so familiar. And are there any other sports that kind of fall into that same category? Just curious.
I think my endurance athletes, like all endurance sports, really, where
if you told a cyclist to get in the pool, would they be better with it or not?
They might more so than a runner, but they'll still miss it. You know, they'll still miss, because that's like, this is who I am in the world, and this is how I interact with the world, is, you know, so that's true for anyone in any sport is like, when this is who, you know, this is how I want to be in the world and who I am in the world. And now I can't do that thing. Mm-hmm. It's, it can be really challenging and you really can just greatly miss that.
Yeah, for sure. And thank you for explaining that. I think that kind of sums up what we have seen from our set for our own selves as well. Now, Cindy, you created the Injured Athletes Club podcast and the Injured Athletes Club Facebook group. And when I first saw this pop up, it kind of made me chuckle to myself because I remember being in college and there was a group of about five of us who were all injured and we were all pool running and we'd meet at the same time and we'd, you know, go around together. And we called ourselves the Ugly Ducklings Club because we were like little ducks floating on the water, just going round and round. And we said that no one wanted to like be in our club. All the other people on the team were like, oh, I don't want to be with them. But then we had like this companionship with each other. So it kind of made me laugh because it suits it so well. Like it kind of does feel a bit like a club because you are left feeling alone and you are left feeling like there's no one else around. So finding like a community you can be a part of is something pretty special. But for you to kind of be driven enough to do this, there must have been an injury that really kind of hit you hard. So what happened there that kind of set this in motion?
Yeah, well, I'll start by saying that Carrie and I together created both of those things. And part of the vision.
Sorry,
that's totally fine. But I wanted to say that because I love your story about the Ugly Ducklings Club so much. And Carrie has worked with collegiate athletes and has had a support group for injured athletes live and in person. And this was part of her vision to really recreate that experience virtually. So she can speak to that a little bit more too. But I can certainly talk about my personal experiences with injuries. I have had so many. I've had four stress fractures. I've had Achilles tendinopathy. I've had high hamstring tendinopathy. And kind of each time I've gone through the difficult psychological process and learned something new, never lessons that I necessarily wanted to know, but lessons that I'm grateful for. And that's something that, you know, we say in the Injured Athletes Club, like you mentioned, it's great to have the club. You don't necessarily want to be there, but since you're there, you're glad that others are there with you. So we always say, we're sorry you're here, but we're glad you're with us. Mm-hmm. I can think of one high hamstring tendinopathy. I dealt with that for a number of years. And I can just think of one run where I, you know, had stopped training and started and stopped and started on just one run where I felt the weight of it, where I just felt like, oh, I'm ready to give up on this altogether and just like started crying in the middle of a run. And I think that's when I realized I needed to do something different with the mental side of it. You know, this was about 4 or 5 years ago now. And I think that's when I started writing more about this specific aspect of the injury process, the psychological process. And that's probably about the time that I first connected with Carrie as an expert source as well. So mm-hmm. I've had so many experiences, but that one in particular, just a moment for whatever reason, mm-hmm. a switch flipped in my mind. And I thought, I'm gonna approach this differently from now on.
Yeah, I think we've all had that. And Carrie, why do injured runners need something like this? Like for someone listening who maybe isn't injured or it's been a while, or even for someone, you know, who is in it, you know, why can't we just be a part of the running community? You know, we're still runners, even if we're just taking a few weeks or even months off. Like why do we need something separate?
I think one of the things that people get from it is, and I sort of knew this from my other work. I work with athletes with type 1 and type 2 diabetes, and we've kind of seeing the way that they connect with each other when there's these diabetes training camps that I'm a part of. You know, and even in, you know, way before that too, like I've always known that community is a really just a crucial part of life, really, and being resilient and in life and getting support with all of the different challenges that you might face. But there was something really powerful, you know, when I, you know, the very first time I saw it actually was I was working at a camp for kids with living with type 1 diabetes, and we worked up in Kings Canyon and lived there for the summer, and these different groups would come in. And I didn't really have any experience with type 1 diabetes, and I saw all these kids come in. And as soon as they got there, their shoulders just dropped and they were just kids and they didn't have to explain anything. They didn't have to explain why they were giving themselves injections. They didn't have to explain why they didn't feel good. Like it just was, they just got to be kids. And I saw how powerful that was to bring people together that have this thing in common. And so I knew that that was something really powerful with injured athletes as well, because even though you have that community, you have that running community and the people that you run with and your teammates, and when you're going through the injury and other people aren't, it can still feel very isolating. And so being able to be a part of a group with other people that are right there in it and going through it at that moment that you feel like you can get support from is just so huge. Because sometimes we hold ourselves back from talking about it with people because we think, oh my God, they're probably sick of me talking about this. Or you might feel like some people are avoiding you because they don't know what to say, or they, so it just is really nice to be able to have that support where it's like, I think I just made a comment about that in the group where somebody had said something about, like, you know, not wanting to bore us. And I was like, no, this is the place you do that. Like, you're not boring us. We want to hear about this. Like, this is, you know, we want to hear about all of the little wins and the challenges you're having today. So having a place for that, I think, you know, it just is a really beautiful thing to be able to have for yourself when you're going through it.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think most people listening can relate to a lot of the things you talked about there. And, you know, you mentioned about people sometimes avoiding you and, you know, it can feel like it's in your head, and sometimes it is and sometimes it isn't. But we also sometimes struggle with, I know I have, being a supportive teammate or friend to other runners during that time. So for those people, and I know I've thought this, like, am I a bad person? Because I, you know, when I'm injured, I struggle to really, I can be happy for people, but not maybe to the extent I would be if I was running and kind of chasing my own goals and doing my own thing as well. So for someone listening, Carrie, like, how can you put their mind at ease that you're not a terrible person if you're not like jumping for joy every time every single one of your friends PRs or does something special?
Yeah, you really are not a terrible person. And that's a very common thing to experience. It's almost an additional emotional challenge of being injured, is then sometimes you'll be feeling guilty for having those feelings of not being excited for your teammates. So it's like this added layer of this whole emotional roller coaster of being injured. And so really, it's just know that that's normal and that it's okay. And you're not a terrible person. And that's an understandable experience to go through, that you're just not in the same place emotionally where you would be unbelievably excited for that person. Because what happens is, as soon as that happens, we kind of have this process of then internalizing it and thinking about our own experience and what we're going through and what we can't do. So just knowing that and honoring that, I think, is important. And once you do that and you kind of recognize, like, oh, I'm feeling like this because of this, you know, I'm feeling really frustrated, or I'm feeling really just sad because I'm not in a place where I get to do that, and sort of, you know, naming that feeling that you're having and honoring that and going through that process. And then once you do that, you'll be able to be like, all right, it's okay for me to feel like this and also be really excited for my teammate that just got a PR.
And Cindy, what about you? Like, during your periods of being injured and you know, from what you've been doing with the Injured Athletes Club, what have you kind of found or discovered for yourself that is going on internally, kind of like what Carrie mentioned, during injuries, that maybe is the part that is often neglected? As we talk about the physical, you need to rest, you need to sleep, you need to eat well, you need to do these things. But what about the emotional side? What have you found?
Yeah, I found, you know, to follow kind of up on what Carrie said in our original point too, about the need for support, that we don't often think through the kinds of support that we need on the psychological side. Like, we think about the kinds of support that we need physically. We think about the physical therapy appointments we need. We think about, do we need crutches? Do we need a walking boot? You know, what physically do we need to heal? But the kinds of support that you need, thinking through those and on the psychological side and really reaching out for those intentionally, I think is something, you know, I didn't realize that was as important as it was until and also that it was something proactive you could do until we started doing this work together. So there are four different types of psychological support that you need. Tangible support, like, you know, someone to help you carry things if you're on crutches. Informational support, so like guidance about the injury process. Motivational support, so people who can kind of cheer you on. Mm-hmm. And then that emotional support, and that's, I feel like sometimes when you're injured, you turn to the same people who are helping you with the physical part of the process for all of those emotional parts of the process too, or you turn to the same, if you have a partner, or, you know, you turn to the same two people or one person for all of those needs. And when you stop to think about that, you know, not only is that overwhelming for you, it gets a little overwhelming for those people too. And it's maybe not the best use of their resources either. So, you know, I've actually found, and I think that many people in the Injured Athletes Club Facebook group have found, that having a place to connect and get that emotional support and motivational support specifically around their injury has also made it easier for them to stay connected to the running community. So they have a place to put those feelings of shame and guilt and sadness and frustration, and then they can reconnect with their running friends. They can be more appreciative. To Carrie's point, once you honor that, those negative feelings and those hard moments, it gives you a little more space to stay connected with the rest of your community in other ways. And I think that all of that is really beneficial for your long-term psychological health, because that facilitates all of these points of connection and community that we've been talking about as being helpful for anyone in any part of life.
Absolutely. And Cindy, what would you say to someone listening who maybe it's been a long time since they've had an injury? They have a friend who's been injured. You know, they maybe understand they can't run with them. They're trying really hard to include them, maybe invited them to go to have coffee, but the friend either kind of seems to be off, not really like talking to them very much, or maybe even the person is just the person who hasn't been injured is struggling to resonate. Someone listening to this who is thinking, okay, I'm just not in that space. Like, you must have had trouble with this with the podcast when you have been healthy, trying to keep putting yourself back in those shoes. So what would be your advice for that kind of person?
Right, exactly. I mean, I think my advice is always to just keep checking in with people and letting them know that you're thinking about them, even if that person isn't necessarily responsive or doesn't come and you feel like you're making an effort and they're not reciprocating. Just the action of reaching out truly makes a difference. And the more you do, and the more you do start to talk to people, you start to realize that the challenges that you face when you're injured are so similar psychologically to the challenges that you face when you encounter another obstacle in your life. And we're all going through hard things at any moment in life. So I always try to reconnect with hard things that I'm facing in my life in that moment when I am talking to someone who's in that place of injury when I'm healthy, and I realize that the experience is more similar than it is different.
Yeah, that's great. And Carrie, what would you add there?
It's so powerful to just know that other people are thinking about you. So, I mean, to Cindy's point, that really is a critical piece of it. So even if you reach out and they don't end up, you know, like, no, I can't, or they make excuses, like, you reaching out and inviting them is such a, you know, it just means so much. And I think that sometimes, you know, Tina, you had brought up a really great point about, you know, how when people feel isolated, sometimes it's perception, but sometimes it's real. And so I think what happens is sometimes and I'm sure it probably has happened, you know, there may be a few people that tuned out because they're like, la, 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 I don't want to hear about injury. You know, like, it's just, and I don't even think it's a conscious thing necessarily where we just like, I don't want to think about that. I don't want to talk about that. Like, I, you know,
kind of almost like it's contagious.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. Exactly. So, which is one of the, a real challenge for people that are injured, because it's like the time they need the most support, they sometimes get the least. And it really is kind of like, all right, you're sidelined. So, you know, let us know when you're better and we'll see you then. And people just forget. I mean, I really honestly think sometimes people just forget. You're in your day to day, you're getting your to-do list done. It's sometimes, which is, you know, painful, the person going through it, but sometimes out of sight, out of mind. And so really, because of that, that's just the reaching out, like Cindy was saying, is means a lot. And to make sure you reach out too, and maybe offer something that's not related to sport, like, hey, come watch the race with me. Like,
yes,
that maybe you offer something else. They might not be ready for that. So get together in another way.
Yeah, I was just going to say, like, surely it's quite good to, you know, let's say you have a running group. I've heard so many times from people that when they're injured, they feel like the whole running group has forgotten them, and that the, you know, they know that they're out there bonding three times a week and you're kind of left at home. So rather than, you know, I use the example of going out for a coffee, but often that's hard because for two runners or a group of runners, it's impossible for the conversation not to end up back on that. Yeah. But if you go to something, you know, different, go to see a show together, a movie together, go to a apple orchard or do something that's like totally different, as a group, or, you know, have a, some kind of dinner, pizza making night or something that like distracts people and is going to somewhat limit the conversation, but make sure that person feels involved, you know, that's different. Surely that's going to help too, to keep them feeling like, yeah, like you said, that they still are being thought of, even if they can't do the physical act of running. So, all right. So let's talk about injuries themselves. You know, looking back on my career, I can see that most injuries I had, even though I was very fortunate, not, I had one calf strain that took me out for a month. But other than that, I really didn't have anything that was long term. But I always felt the need when I was injured, like, all right, time to put your head down. You're going to knuckle through this. You're going to visualize yourself being successful. And I'm going to like work my ass off every day in the gym, because, you know, I just felt like that was the way to do it. Like, force through. I'm going to fight my way back. I would love to hear both of your opinions on this. So whoever wants to start can start. Do you think that it is ever, is that always the approach that a runner should take? Because that is kind of the, not the perceived way that people do it, but most people feel, okay, I'm injured. I need to keep my fitness. I can't lose anything. I need to keep going and keep fighting. Is there ever a good time to say, you know what? This is a good time to just take a total reset, take all exercise off, give myself 2 weeks or whatever to just completely relax, try and re-find myself, kind of almost forget about running for a few weeks. Is there ever a good time to do that? And when do you know which time to kind of fight through and which time to go for it? I mean, to, sorry, rest.
See, I love you did both, right? So yeah. When should you go for it? And then when should you go for it?
Yeah. Right? That, you can tell that's what my response is.
Right? I know. So this is Carrie. So I'll, you know, I think that it's a great question, because I think sometimes people struggle with that too, of knowing when to push and when to back off. And when you're an athlete and you're used to pushing, especially with my endurance athletes, it's sort of in you to want to push. And so I tell my injured athletes sometimes that like, it takes more mental toughness to stop and to take that break and to focus on your recovery than it does to push through. That really, that's the thing that in those moments can really be a true sign of that mental toughness, is like, oh, I want this so bad. And so I think that there's, you know, I'm always going to go back to the injury first and foremost. And what is it that your body needs? Like, does your body need that 2 weeks off? That might be a critical for you to do, but it can be a really powerful mental reset too. You know, so it's going to be injury dependent, and it's going to be athlete dependent as well. You know, one of the reasons I think people do want to push is exactly what you said, Tina, where you're just, you know, there's so many things when you get injured, there's so many sort of fears and worries that you have. And one of them that I hear a lot from endurance athletes is everybody else is gaining fitness while I'm losing it. And it's, I think that's sometimes people push maybe more than their body is ready for, because they're trying to hold on to some of that fitness.
And that's what social media shows as well, right? Everyone is going for, everyone's in the pool cross training, whereas no one's taking a picture of their feet on the couch.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And there's this very romanticized idea of pushing through and getting back and the comeback. And so I think, that's such a huge point that you just made, where it's really important to know too, that might also be happening, but not be what we're seeing on social media. We might just be seeing that romanticized piece of like the comeback, instead of this other recovery piece that's really an essential part of that comeback as well.
Yeah. Thank you. Cindy, what would you say?
Yeah, I think absolutely. I agree with everything that Carrie pointed out. And I would add that this actually, I mean, as she says, it's injury dependent, right? I think there are a lot of times with bone stress injuries, which is something that I have been through, it actually is really, really beneficial to rest completely and let your body use those resources that you would otherwise be putting into cross training to heal your bone. And sometimes you say, for instance, need to gain weight or need to think about your nutrition differently and all of that. But I would say that one of the benefits of also attending to the psychological aspect of your recovery is that part of that is going to be this process of self-inquiry. It's going to be getting to really in touch with your feelings and your and your body too, and asking yourself deep down, do I feel like this is the time to push, or do I really feel like I need the time to rest? Because I think we might have a little bit more internal knowledge of that than we think we do sometimes, but it's really hard to tap into that and listen to it. So the kinds of tools and techniques that we offer in our book Rebound, and just even, you know, taking any approach to mental skills or sports psychology in terms of dealing with injury, I think will help you tap into that and uncover that answer for yourself.
Yeah. Okay. So let's talk about the book for a minute there. You know, we kind of mentioned a little bit about where it came from, but Rebound, Train Your Mind to Bounce Back Stronger from Sports Injuries. Tell us why you felt this was a topic that was needed. I mean, Carrie, I guess from what we got earlier, that was kind of your idea in the first place. I don't know, correct me if I'm wrong, but tell us about where the idea came from.
I think it really started for me during my graduate studies when I was injured. So I had a couple, and I talk about this in the book, in the introduction, somewhere in the book, I talk about how I had this experience of I had two different knee injuries on the same knee. And one of those injuries was before my graduate studies. And I had a really hard time coming back from that injury and regaining my confidence, and just struggled. And this was before I knew sports psychology even existed. And then fast forward a few years, I'm deep in my studies. I think I was just starting year two, and I ended up getting another knee injury, a different one. The first one was meniscus tear with some surgery to clean some stuff up. This one was I tore my MCL, and almost really honestly, within about an hour, I've been thinking about this a lot recently. Pretty quickly, I was like, oh, I'm going to use this as an opportunity, and I'm going to take absolutely everything that I am learning in my studies and apply it to coming back. And I came back and had the most incredible season ever. I mean, the difference between those two recoveries in terms of my mental state was profound. That's not to say that I didn't struggle. There were moments I definitely struggled, but I had the tools to be able to know what to do when it happened. And so, you know, that was really a big moment for me where I thought, oh my God, why this needs to be available to everybody. Like this shouldn't just be something that we're sharing with elite athletes or that, you know, we're just learning about in the classroom. And so, but it was, you know, it was a long time before this book came to fruition, where really it was running some of those support groups for injured athletes. And then also just working with more and more injured athletes and realizing that they had all this support for their physical recovery and not really any support for their mental recovery. And then even as we were in the middle of the process of writing the book and kind of doing research on what else was out there, it was like, how's this book not already existing? This is crazy. Like, this is so crazy. So it just really was like, oh, it's time for this book to be in the world, because we know definitively through the research what a huge impact working on your mental skills training can have through the injury recovery process and building that resilience and being able to actually experience growth through this challenging time. Your mental skills have a significant part in that. So we had all this research about it, but no one was actually working with the athletes to let them know, like, here's what you can do.
Yes. Yes. Thank you. And just to go slightly off topic there, you mentioned about you decided during this injury that you were going to take this opportunity and do something about it. Someone listening may not have the kind of credentials you do, or may not be able to write a book or whatever, but how could someone listening take the opportunity of being injured or going, it doesn't even have to be an injury. Maybe it's a setback. Maybe things are really going wrong. Give us some examples or some ideas of how someone listening could take their own kind of setbacks in life and, turn it around, take the power back.
I think a big piece of that is one of the things we have a tendency to do when we experience a setback of some kind is to look at that and examine it under a microscope and just be sort of stuck in the immediacy of what's going on. And one of the ways that can be empowering to view it is to step back and look at it from a greater perspective. So I think it was earlier, Cindy had mentioned the hero's journey. And so the hero's journey is, if you think about movies like The Hunger Games or The Wizard of Oz or Harry Potter, there's these movies that follow the storyline of the hero's journey, where you take a everyday person, and they suddenly are being tested in some way, and they need to, they have all these challenges and they need to overcome them. And then once they do, they have new knowledge and they're a different person than they were before. So when you step back and look at a setback from that viewpoint, then you know this is part of the experience. This is part of being an athlete, or this is part of life. There is no life, and then there is no athletic journey without the challenge. Mm-hmm. And so when you can step back and look at that and go and know the cycle and know like, oh, here's where I am on the cycle. And eventually I am going to come through it and I am going to be different because of it. When you can kind of view it from that lens, that's not to say it won't be challenging and you won't be angry and hurt and depressed and go through all of those normal emotional response, but you'll also know I am going to come out on the other side of this and I am going to be a different person because of it.
Mm-hmm. I love that. Cindy, anything you'd add there?
I would add that there is an exercise in our book. Something that I've learned from Carrie is an actual mental drill you can do called obstacles to opportunities. And it's where you take even a small setback and you think, okay, your natural reaction to that is this is going to suck, right? But you can change your thinking one step at a time. So you kind of go from this is going to suck, think about that and think about how that makes you feel. Then think this is going to be hard and then see how that makes you feel. And then think this is going to be a challenge and see how that makes you feel. And then you can get to this is going to be an opportunity and see how that makes you feel. And you kind of walk through that step by step. It's like even, and if you do it with small situations every day, you start to practice it and it starts to get easier to do it with a bigger obstacle. And I think that I think of it as like kind of some of those word puzzles where you start with one 4-letter word and you change one letter at a time to make a different word. You don't have to think of, all right, here's an obstacle. How do I immediately see it as an opportunity? You can kind of walk through it one step at a time. And to Carrie's point about these being skills, you get better at them when you practice them.
Yes. Yeah, like anything.
Exactly. Yeah. That's such a great point too, right? Because you're going to have people that might be listening. And I've had people say this to me and they're like, Carrie, I don't want to hear about your little opportunity. So like there is no opportunity here. Like you're just not ready to hear that. So to Cindy's point, like having the steps of like, even if you can move from, you know, defining the situation from, oh my God, this is going to suck to this is going to be hard. There's an emotional shift and there's a shift in the lens that you're looking at it through, which is really critical. So I mean, that's such an important point that there's a time and a place for, I had a lot of practice. So pretty quickly in that particular moment, I was able to see the opportunity. But there's been other injuries where I've had, it was interesting because Cindy and I actually were both injured at some different points while writing the book. And I was in big fat denial about my injury for months. So, you know, you're not always necessarily in the space to like immediately see that opportunity, but to, like Cindy said, with practice, you do get there more quickly.
I don't know if you noticed, but a few months ago, I kind of hated social media. I couldn't stand it, not because of everyone else, and usually that is the cause, but it was actually myself. I felt so much pressure to put up a photo, and a good photo. It couldn't be a great or a fantastic photo, because if it was by a photographer, I was losing that authenticity. But it couldn't just be a photo of my feet, which was what I was actually looking at most of the time in reality while I was sitting on the couch. But I felt so much pressure and I felt like I had so much to say, but it just felt fake, like going to take a picture just for the sake of it. I don't know about you, but I really miss those kind of long communications where it's not about like 3 tips to help you do this or tag a friend to do that, but not something that get you to click, but just good old fashioned emails, you know, like the ones I would send my friends while I was on my lunch break at work before the days of iPhones. I love that like personal nature while at the same time, you know, letting it flow out onto the keyboard, letting your real self, kind of the way that you talk, flow out onto the keyboard. And I love writing emails in the same way that I would speak them, the way that you're hearing me right now. And that is my goal with these emails. It's not to sell you stuff. It's not to bombard you with emails, but I want to connect with you. I want to get to know you and talk to you the way that I would talk to any of my friends. And I love the replies that I receive every week. It makes me feel like I'm getting to know you a little bit better. I know you get to know me really well through this show. but I love that I can also kind of hear you too. So I am talking about, as I haven't actually mentioned it yet, my Running For Real, my email newsletter that comes out once a week, every Monday. It's just a thought for the week, you know, some kind of long chat about what I've been thinking about, something that is kind of going on, just kind of within me or within friends and things like that, something I'm thinking about. Often I have a bit of a talent for making it resonate with people. It's all about treating yourself better, becoming the best person you can be. And just kind of, if you like me in this podcast, you'll probably enjoy it. There's also some updates for the week and some recommendations, more just kind of things that I've been listening to or reading that I've been really enjoying. No pressure to click on any of those or anything. I'm not selling anything. Well, very rarely. I'm not spamming you. I'm just talking to you. So if you enjoy that, you can go to tinamuir.com/subscriber. You can also find it in the show notes if you want to check it there. So again, that's tinamuir.com/subscriber. Sign up and I can't wait to get to know you more.
It was interesting because Cindy and I actually were both injured at some different points while writing the book. And I was in big fat denial about my injury for months. So, you know, you're not always necessarily in the space to like immediately see that opportunity, but to, like Cindy said, with practice, you do get there more quickly.
Yeah. And I think I definitely feel this way, but I think most people, if you look back on your injuries, you're glad they happened. Like, and I always say that to people when they're injured and they give me that, like, I'm going to punch you in the face. Like, don't you dare say that to me. But it's true. Like, it really, it does, it teaches you something. It like allows some other door to open that otherwise wouldn't. Like, it never feels like it during, and you're just like cursing and you're so mad, but it often does lead to something even greater. So to anyone listening who is in this situation, hang in there. Now let's talk about the identity part of it. We talked a little bit about this. Carrie, you mentioned right at the beginning that runners tend to, you know, really struggle more than maybe even any other sport with kind of not being able to do their one thing. But so we do feel like we lose a part of ourselves. But why is that? For, you know, it's so easy for people to say, well, it's just running. And it makes you feel ashamed because it is just running, but we can't just let it go as that. Why is that?
Yeah, I think, you know, just like any part of, you know, we all have these different identities that we take on and different roles that we have in our lives. And so when you're an athlete, a lot of times you take on, you might have a high athletic identity. And so whatever that identity is, whether it's maybe it's a mother or a father or in your job, your career, we have these different identities that we take on in these different roles. And sometimes our feelings of self-worth might be more connected to one identity over another. And so when you're a runner and you're suddenly injured, the experience can feel like, well, if I can't run, that means I'm not a runner. If I can't do the thing, that means I'm no longer an athlete. You feel like you lose a part of yourself because you feel like you lose that athletic identity. When really, if you step back and look at that bigger picture, you're still an athlete. You just, now your recovery is your sport, and all of the energy and effort you were putting into running now is put into your recovery and coming back from that piece. So it is interesting that we, you know, with all of the people we've interviewed for the, that Cindy interviewed for the book and that we've interviewed for the Injured Athletes Club podcast, we hear this again and again, similar to what you said, Tina, about they would never want to go through it again, and they would never wish it upon anyone, but they were grateful for the experience because they got so much out of it. Really no trusting that. And I know sometimes, you know, there is a time where people are like, I can't hear that right now, but maybe if you don't believe it for yourself, you can believe in the fact that somebody else does believe that and just hold on to that, that that person thinks that this is true and is telling me this is true. And I can believe that they think that, even if I'm not ready to believe it for myself. And that just kind of opens that possibility and opens that door. So for some people, it might be if they lose another part of their identity, they might, you know, it might be a huge blow to them. But when you're an athlete and you're used to using your body as a part of the way you experience the world. And when you lose that, it can be really, really hard. And if you're not an athlete, you know, so sometimes for people who have your support system, maybe include people that aren't runners, they might not get that, which yes. is another reason why the Injured Athletes Club is such a big deal. And having that support is because we do get it. And everybody there gets how important this is to you. And it is a big deal, even if there's other people that don't understand why that's a big deal.
So just to take that one step further, and Cindy, I'd like you to maybe answer this one. For people listening who feel like, I'm not an elite athlete, I'm not even competitive, I shouldn't be this upset about this. I have a great career, I have a family, I have all these things, so this really shouldn't bother me because running is just a hobby, it's just something I do. So why do I feel so bad? What would you say to that specific person who maybe doesn't feel like an athlete? They just feel like, you know, running is something that kind of gives them freedom or gives them something to work towards, like, but they still feel maybe even more guilty because it really shouldn't bother me. So why does it?
Yeah. There's so many things I would say, and I feel like I do say to these people all the time because those are so, so common. So just knowing that that is a common reaction, I think, is really helpful. I would also say that the answer to your question is in part to your question. I mean, there's so many reasons why we run. So if it's stress relief, if it's toward a big, to accomplish a bigger goal, to feel good about yourself, to connect with friends. I mean, when you start to think about all of the reasons why you run, you can start to understand why it is so hard when you can't do it. That one thing is filling so many roles in your life and you're getting so much out of it. So it's completely understandable to be upset when that's taken away from you, especially if a big piece of it is stress relief. So then you're stressed about your injury and all of the things that go along with taking care of that. And you're also robbed of one of your main coping mechanisms. So of course, that's going to be difficult. Recognize that that's normal. And another thing that I like to say is that there's enough suffering to go around. So it's true that there, you know, maybe there, if you were an elite athlete, there would be an added level because then you aren't able to make a living at the same time as all of these other consequences are happening. However, I mean, the fact that you are going through this setback actually makes you more able to connect with someone at that level. So it doesn't take away from the disappointment and the sadness that you feel to honor that other people are also going through difficult things. And you know, and vice versa, right? If you were to talk with someone else going through any kind of a setback, I think you can, again, recognize those commonalities and realize it's not a comparison game and that it's normal and healthy and okay for you to be upset and sad, and that feeling guilty about it just kind of adds to your burden and it isn't necessary.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you so much for that. So let's talk about, for someone, let's do it into two categories here. So we've mentioned about refinding, you know, your identity, realizing you're more than just a runner, rediscovering who you are, finding other things you enjoy, doing those things with, you know, running people or not. But let's go through two scenarios. One is we're just going to do more of the temporary, the short-term thing. So for someone who's got a little thing that's flared up, you need maybe 3 days off, not much, absolutely spending the day panicking, prodding your leg every 10 minutes, you know, just freaking out. What would be, I'd love for you to just both give a little quick reminder to that person right now. So Carrie can start with you. What would you like to say to that person?
I think, you know, just breathe first and foremost, you know, I think that's, I think that can be really critical actually, because sometimes when we're in the midst of a intense emotional experience, we might feel like you're going to feel that way forever. So to know, and then we also have this tendency to time travel. So we might like immediately start thinking about the what ifs and like, what does this mean? And what if I can't, you know, run 3 weeks from now? And am I going to miss my race? And, you know, we just like immediately kind of go time travel into the future. So I think the most important thing is to kind of take a beat, take a breath, pull yourself back, and as much as possible, really try and take it one day at a time. And bring yourself into the present moment. Go, okay, well, what do I need to know right now? I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I don't know what's going to happen 3 weeks from now. Like, what do I need to do right now in this moment? And know, whatever you're feeling in that moment, you're not going to feel that way forever.
Mm-hmm. Cindy, what would you say?
Yeah, I would echo that. The breathing for sure is huge, because sometimes you don't notice that you're not really doing that until you start to pay attention to it. So stop, take a deep breath. I think too, we have in the book an exercise called a pain log. So this can be useful if you are coming off of a long-term injury too, but even for a short-term kind of niggle, to kind of notice what you're feeling, even write it down, be really specific about it, and then let it go for that moment. It's important to be in touch with your body, of course, but if you start to obsess and poke, and I've certainly done this, I don't know if anyone who's had a stress reaction or a stress fracture knows the hop test, but I can't tell you how many times I've done the hop test on my own, just test, okay, now is it healed? And, but if I just am in tune with my body and write down what I'm feeling and then talk with my healthcare team, people that I trust, that calms me and it just doesn't take away sometimes it does take away the physical pain too, but it just puts it all in perspective.
Yes. Okay. Thank you. All right. And then someone who's got a longer term thing, yeah, a few weeks to a few months to longer, or maybe they've just been struggling for longer, like wondering if they even want to continue running because things just don't seem to be coming together. What would you say to that person to finding other things that matter to them, to finding that balance that they feel like deep down they might have lost? So Carrie, maybe we'll start again with you.
Yeah, I think, it can be a challenging situation to be in and be really, it's very normal to think about too, like, do I want to continue when you're facing a longer term injury? So every injury you have is unique. And sometimes it can be confusing to athletes when they have an injury where they're like, I don't know what's going on because I came back fine before and now I have this injury and I'm really struggling with my confidence and I'm questioning whether I want to even continue. And that is a normal, natural thing to happen sometimes. So, I mean, that's a big piece of it, is just knowing like whatever you're feeling is okay. And you might not have the answers right now, and that's okay too. We really don't like uncertainty. Mm-hmm. Our brains are always grasping to try and like, what's the answer, and like pull, you know, ground underneath us so we have something to stand on. And so sometimes with injury and unknowns, especially if you have an injury that maybe they haven't quite figured out what's going on yet, oh gosh, it can be really mentally and emotionally exhausting to feel like you're constantly trying to bring ground underneath you, when really it might be, how can I settle into this unknown right now? And are there other things I can focus on? Like, and really trying to focus on the things that you can do, instead of just getting stuck and hooked by all of the things that you can't do and all of the unknowns.
Yep. So good. Thank you. And Cindy?
Yeah, I would just add that sort of all of the other things that you might be doing for your body and your health and your stress reduction when you are in training are really important to keep doing when you're injured too, mm-hmm. because that kind of helps you again in that discernment process. Like, it's totally okay if you are frustrated and you decide, maybe I don't want to come back to running, or maybe I want to take a longer break. But you want to really make that from a place of confidence and security and not from fear. And as Carrie mentions, this uncertainty that troubles us. So attending to those things, making sure you're getting enough sleep, paying attention to your nutrition and really building in things that just bring you joy in the moment, as well as things that are fulfilling for you longer term. All of that is actually an important part of your recovery too. Mm-hmm. And I think that we kind of forget that, and it's easy to let those things slip when we're not training hard, but that they can also help with this psychological piece too.
Well, like what you, one of your chapters in the book was recovery is now your sport. And mm-hmm. you kind of talk, and you obviously have a lot of chapters that cover those different areas that are just as critical or even more critical when you are in recovery from an injury as they are during training. I also want to mention in the show notes, I'll also put a link to go get my PDF download for a joy list, which is just, I've got like 100 and something options or things that you could do instead of running, or while you're not able to run, or as well as running, whatever it may be. So just for everyone, I'll put that in there. All right. So just wrapping up here, we've mentioned the club, the Facebook group and the podcast. Just out of curiosity's sake, do you find that as soon as people are healthy again, they kind of leave the group, or they mute it or something, so the group is constantly changing? Or do you find that people tend to kind of stay and then be the next kind of generation of support for the incoming people coming in? So Cindy, if you want to maybe do that one.
That is a great question. And we see some of both, actually. And I think it's going to be really personal in terms of what is helpful for that person mm-hmm. and where they are in their journey. I think there's some people, and we found this too with the athletes that we interviewed for the book, the part of the thing that they come away with sometimes is greater empathy and also a really strong desire to help other people who have been where they've been. So I think that does happen a lot. And I think that they often don't post as frequently, but they might post every once in a while to say, here's how I'm doing now. I just want you to continue to keep hope that you can get to this place too. And people seem to respond well to that. So I think mm-hmm. there are some people that will lose, and that's normal and natural and healthy for them probably. But I do appreciate those who stay around and offer like injury mentorship.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We've even had people ask us like, well, I'm healed now. Is it okay if I still stay in the group? And we're like, of course. Like, and unfortunately we've also had some people that are like, okay, I'm back. So mm-hmm. I have another injury, you know? So I think Cindy's right. Like, I think sometimes people kind of may step back, but they're still there and following. And sometimes they're too, like maybe a year out of their injury, but then posting like something amazing that they did. Yeah, exactly.
Which is so good. And so for anyone listening who is in that kind of just healed state, maybe consider joining the group and sharing where you've come, what you've managed to do, and what helped you through, because it might help other people too. All right. So just finally to talk about the book Rebound, Train Your Mind to Bounce Back Stronger from Sports Injuries. I will put links in the show notes for everyone to go find it. But what do you both hope this book does? So Cindy, maybe start with you.
I hope it helps athletes feel like they're not alone when they're injured and that there is something they can do about it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you, Carrie.
I think, you know, I hope that it helps people recognize that there is both a mental and physical recovery, and there are things that you can do for that mental recovery, and that it doesn't mean that you're weak. If you're struggling, it just means you might not have the tools to know how to manage that emotional landscape of being injured. So I really hope that people get that, like, oh, this isn't a critical part and there is something I can do about it.
Yes. Okay, great. Thank you so much. All right. For those listening, where can people find you to follow along in the future? Cindy?
Sure. So, well, we have a website for all things book and injured athletes club related, which is just injuredathletesclub.com. So there you can find links to buy the book, to download worksheets that go with the book, to the podcast, and to the Facebook group. And I also have a website. My own website and social media is just Cindy Kuzma.
Okay. All right, Carrie?
I've got my own website as well. It's carriecheadle.com and Instagram and Twitter. I'm @feedtheathlete. And then also have a Carrie Cheadle's Mental Skills Training Facebook group.
Okay, great. Oh, well, both of you, thank you so much for, you know, taking on the task of writing this book. As you said, it was kind of shocking that it wasn't out there. As Matt Fitzgerald, you have on the front here, assigned reading for every athlete I coach. Matt is very well recognized and appreciated within our sport. So that says a lot right there. Thank you both for sharing with us, and look forward to hearing some success stories of some of your runners who have read the book in the future.
Thank you so much for having us, Tina. And thanks for all you do to honor some of the struggles and to help athletes everywhere work on I don't want to say their mental toughness, but their mental well-being.
Yeah. Thank you. My friends, if you have a minute and you could leave a review on your favorite podcast player, Apple Podcasts, iTunes, Stitcher, Overcast, Pocket Cast, Spotify, or whatever else podcast player you use to listen to this podcast, or if you would subscribe to this podcast, you will help me get out in front of new runners to make our tribe even bigger and even better. It might not seem like you as one person can make a difference, but really, it helps a lot. And it shows me you appreciate the hard work I put in for those. Thank you so much.
What great advice from those two women, and a conversation that I think is well needed, especially as we can quite often, you know, ignore the topic of injuries, because by the time we would think about doing something about it, if we have been injured, we are healthy again and we don't want to think about it and we don't want to jinx ourselves with more injuries. So we kind of just tend to move on. I love what Carrie and Cindy have done, and definitely go join their Facebook group. especially if you are struggling with something right now. But even if you're not, why not go be that supportive person who, you know, goes to help these people? And actually, on that note, the other day I was in the airport, as of my recording this, I was in the airport and I saw a woman who was crying, and I walked up to her and I said, "Are you okay?" And she said, "No, my friend just died." And you know, I rubbed her back a little bit, not in a creepy way, but in a kind way. And I just said, "You know, I'm so sorry. That's so hard." And I said, "Do you need a hug?" And she said, "Yeah." And so I gave her a hug. And then later she thanked me and said, "You know, that was the nicest thing someone could have done." And it's things like that, like with someone who's injured, you listening to this episode if you're not injured, or you going to join that Facebook group if you're not injured, to support people who are, especially if there's someone who you care about, who you know and love. It just means so much. Those little gestures can just mean the world to people. So try and do some more of those. All right. So next week we have Hillary Allen, who has an incredible story. Hillary was coming up as one of the best ultra runners out there before she fell during a race, fell over 150 feet down, broke so many bones in her body, you know, easily could have died. Not only survived, got, you know, helicoptered away, and not just made it through, but she kind of has returned and she's doing well and she's found a new passion for the sport. Really inspiring story. So I'm looking forward to hearing your thoughts on that. Now, I just want to tell you about our sponsors for this episode, because without them, I know sponsorship can be please stop talking about that. But that is one way you can really support me and show your appreciation for what I do here at Running For Real. If you purchase products through my sponsor links and purchase things because of them, it really helps to support me, because they continue to invest in us and our group and, you know, this community. So thank you for anyone who has purchased anything through my links. And today I want to thank Vital Farms for sponsoring this episode. So you can enter to win a year's supply of ghee by going to vitalfarms.com/ghee, and make sure you put in there that you came from me, because there is a little drop down to say where you heard of it. You can win a year's supply worth of ghee, which ghee again is for cooking with. It is so much better than butter. Taste wise, it's just delicious, makes all your cooking kind of go up a level. So it's fantastic. Definitely go check that out. And also, I mentioned my email during this episode. So you can go sign up at tinamuir.com/subscriber if you want to go sign up there. You can also find links to everything we talked about today in the show notes at tinamuir.com/174. And that, my friends, is it. I will see you next week.
Thanks for listening to the Running For Real podcast. Be sure to check out tinamuir.com for show notes and even more helpful running information.